similar. Tomorrow is a new year. Quick show of hands. How many of you made New Year's resolutions? Okay. How many of you have in the past made them and broken them? Got a lot more hands on that one. The whole line up there. A survey revealed the top 10 New Year's resolutions. Survey says, number one, get in shape. Exercise more. We go to the gym faithfully for 2 or 3 weeks, and by February we start missing a few days, then by March, workouts, who's got time for that? You've gone through that one, I know, I have. How about number two? Survey says, lose weight. I'll eat better, and I'm going to stick to this diet. I'm going to hang on until I shed all this excess weight. I'm going to lose 10 pounds, and then we gain back 20. Number three, survey says, quit smoking. Many of you have done that. You complain that, well, I've done that. I've done it 27 times. Quitting smoking is more difficult than quitting cocaine. It's more addictive than that. So if you've tried it and failed, I at least give you kudos for trying. And I'm not speaking that it's more powerful than cocaine from experience. But if you're a teenager or a preteen, make this pledge today. I will not smoke. I will not start smoking. I will only smoke if I'm on fire. I want you to make that pledge. This is the most difficult habit to break. Rounding out the survey, we have number four, at spend more time with family and friends. Number five, enjoy life more, have more fun, stress less. Number six, fall in love, find a significant other. Number seven, get out of debt. Number eight, learn something new like PowerPoint, T-Rex, jumping jacks. Number nine, help other people. Number 10, get organized. Notice that most of these center around physical ideas, things of this earth. And some of them touch the fringes of the spiritual, like maybe stress less or get out of debt or help others. But for the most part, they're not focused on spiritual assets. And many of us have made New Year's resolutions so many times and failed that we pretty much have given up. We don't even try anymore. You're sick and tired of hearing about that concept year after year. And I understand that, and I'm sensitive to that. So I'm not even going to mention New Year's resolutions anymore. Instead, I want to take us in a totally different direction this morning. In fact, today's sermon is going to be on annual objectives. How can we use the tool of annual objectives to help us in our Christian growth? Well, one thing's for sure, the Bible tells us that we must grow as Christians. God commands it, and annual objectives will help us to accomplish this goal. In Hebrews chapter 5, I'd like to look at verses 12 to 14. There it says, For the time that you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk, and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. For strong meat belongeth to them that are full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. So the Bible is telling us that we need to graduate from milk to meat. We need to grow. We need to mature in Christ. How are you growing? I want you to ask that question. I want you to be very brutally honest about it. From January 1st of 2017 until now, what has changed in your life for good? How have you grown spiritually? I want you to benchmark that and think about it. Are you praying more? Are you praying less? Are you studying more? Are you studying less? Have you memorized any scripture?
Or have you forgotten a scripture?
You need to ask those questions to yourself. You need to make New Year's Eve a day of inventory of our growth spiritually. We need to inspect our fruits. We need to search our hearts. We need to see just how are we growing? How did we become stronger this past year? In Philippians chapter 3, I'd like us to look at verses 12 through 14. There it says, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that, for which I also am apprehended through Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark, the prize, the high calling of God, Christ Jesus. We haven't yet attained the resurrection. That's what Paul is saying in verse 13. I don't count myself as to have already apprehended this. We're not already perfect. We're not already totally like Christ, are we? We have a long ways to go. And we have a lot of room for growth. In verse 13, he tells us that we can't rest on our laurels. He says he put those things in the past behind him. He doesn't think about them anymore. Now, that we should think about them to learn lessons and to gauge ourselves and for growth. But don't rest on your laurels and your past achievements. And the other thing that Paul's saying here is that neither should we condemn ourselves for our past failures. You know, God, just like we have a new year, every morning is new. Every morning that we wake up is a brand new day that God gives us. And we can have forgiveness and he takes our sins as far as the east is from the west. We have a clean slate every morning. And we should forget our past failures and don't let those drag us down. Don't repeat the past. You know, if we feel like we're a failure, we're going to fail again. Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So we need to put good things into our heart so that we aim at something higher. And in verse 14, it tells us how to do that. First of all, we live in the present. We press toward the mark. In other words, the only thing that you can change is what you're doing today. You can't change the past. You can't do anything about the future. You can only take charge of today. That's where you have power. So live in the moment. Live day by day in the moment. And we should press toward the mark, the prize, the high calling of God, Christ Jesus. We need to aim for that prize, for the high calling of Jesus. God wants you and I to press toward that mark. He wants us pursuing this prize. He doesn't want you to have the largest house and the biggest bank account and the nicest clothes. It doesn't say that. He wants us to press toward the mark, the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Annual objectives will help you get there. If you aim at nothing, guess what? You're going to hit it. You're going to hit it every time. We need to have a goal. We need to have a prize. We need to have a mark that we're aiming for. And that's what Paul is telling us in that verse. Then let's flip over to 2 Peter. And I'd like to look at verses 5 to 10. It's 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 to 10. And God is telling us in this section of Scripture, He expects us to grow. We need to be growing. We can't just stay stagnant. We can't just stay neutral. It says there, and besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, it make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he is purged from his old sins. Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall. This is telling us a lot there. But what it's saying is that we need to be growing. We need to continually be pressing toward the mark. We need to be becoming more and more Christ-like. We need to add all of these virtues to our faith. You start out with faith, don't you? That's the seed, the mustard seed that you start with. But it needs to grow. It needs to gain all these other characteristics with it, all these segments of faith. So God wants you to add to your faith. He doesn't want you to be satisfied standing still. He doesn't want you to just obey the gospel and that's it. You can check out at that point. Stagnant water attracts disease. Mosquitoes come there and breed in it. And before you know it, it's a swamp. And if you're not growing spiritually, you're dying. Think about that. When you look back at last year, and you see that you've actually regressed in some areas, you've forgotten some scriptures, you don't study as much as you used to, you don't pray like you used to pray, you're dying. You're slowly dying. And that's a warning to us. And that's why I'm asking you to do this, to look at your spiritual life and see how far you've progressed this year. Because gradually, that's how most of us will fall away. And that's how we lose our souls. It's a gradual thing. It's a drifting away. It's not a fall off a cliff. It's our hearts slowly harden. Our consciences slowly become seared. And it can take several years for this process to happen. So make sure you're growing and it won't happen. When we look at what it says, it's wherefore brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. If you do these things, you shall never fall. You want to be guaranteed against falling? Keep adding to your faith. Keep growing. Keep moving forward. Press toward the mark, prize of the calling of God. Well, how do we set annual objectives? We need to have a starting place. In Proverbs, I'd like to look at chapter 28, verse 13. Proverbs 28:13 says, "He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, and whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy." So that's a starting point. You know, start right where you are. Is there some sin in your life that you're sheltering? Is there jealousy? Is there unforgiveness? Perhaps you gossip. Perhaps there's greed in your heart. Perhaps you're blaming other people for your wrong instead of taking full responsibility yourself. Or maybe you're living with an addiction. Maybe there's something like that lurking in your heart. And it says that if we try to cover that sin, we're not going to prosper. So my thought to you this morning is that that's exactly where you need to start. That's ground zero. Is there something like that that you have in your heart that you're hiding? That you think it's okay to hang on to unrighteousness while you're professing to be a Christian? You can't. If you cover your sin, you're not going to prosper. God tells us that. And in Proverbs chapter 6, 27 lets us know that it always ends badly. When you try to hold sin in your heart, it says, "Can a man take fire in his bosom and not be burned?" Absolutely not. If you hold sin in your life, you're thinking that it's not going to hurt you, you're thinking that you're getting away with it, that it's consequence-free, you're wrong, you're disillusioned. Because it's going to catch up to you and it's going to hurt you. It's going to hurt people that you love. You're going to be burned. In Hosea 8:7, I think you can finish this one for me. If we sow through the wind, what do we reap? The whirlwind. It's only gets worse. It's infinitely worse. In James chapter 1, talks about what happens when we hold on to sin. We need to, it's poison, it's a toxin, it's cancer that we need to get out of our hearts. In James 1, verses 13 through 15, it says, "Let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it's finished, bringeth forth death." And it tells us the progression there. We start out with that sinful thought, we plant it in our heart, we don't pluck it out of there, we don't challenge it like it tells us to do. It tells us to cast down any thoughts and imaginations that exalt themselves against the knowledge of God. But we refuse to do that, we let it stay. And guess what? It's a progressive illness. And it makes you sick, and then it leads to death. So you don't want spiritual death. You need to get that out of your life. We need to pray a very courageous prayer that we find in the book of Psalms. I'd like to look at chapter 139, verses 23 and 24. Psalm 139, 23 and 24 says, "Search me, O God, and try to know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me the way everlasting." This is a bold prayer, isn't it? Come before God, delay your heart open to Him, and say, "God, search me. Look at my heart. Show me where there's any wicked way, if there's any darkness in there, if there's any sin, if there's some lie that I planted there that I'm not challenging, if there's something that's leading me to sin, clean it out of my heart. Take it out of my heart. And lead me in the way everlasting, in the right way. Help me to make a righteous choice in my life. Help me get the sin eradicated out of my heart." It's a bold prayer, but we need to be praying that, because all of us have twisted hearts. Jeremiah tells us that the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked above all things. Who could know it? So we need to be praying this prayer to God, because we can't see the things, all those things in our heart. There's some things that are buried there that have been buried for years. And maybe it was put in there in our childhood years, our formative years. And we're just autopilot responding to them. You know, the sin that comes out, the sin that we're tempted with, it's because of something that was planted there a long time ago. And we're too blind to see it. Sometimes we just need to be praying that prayer to God. Show us any wicked way in our heart. Reveal it to us. Give me wisdom. Open my eyes. Help me see it. James 5:16 says that when you finally do say that prayer, it says, "Confess your faults one to another, praying one for another, that you may be healed. Effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much." So when we see that sin, confess it. That's how you heal sin. It's like putting light on it. It's like putting a disinfectant on it. That's how it kills it. Is when we confess it to God. And when you can confess it to, you know, if you have a close friend or you trust, and then we can pray with you about it, hopefully it's your spouse. And hopefully you have that kind of relationship with some transparency and honesty with your spouse to be able to do that. But find someone else that you can share that issue with and confess it. And that's how you kill it. That's the foundational, fundamental, first way. You don't cover it up. You don't pretend it's not there. You don't make excuses for it. You don't blame other people, but confess it. And that's what gets the process of healing started. In 1 John 1:9, we are told to confess our faults. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So that's the process. When we locate that sin in our heart and see it in our life, we confess it to God. And it says He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. That's how we cleanse that out of our hearts. So, step number one. That's where we start. Start where you are. You know, if you know where you're broken already, and most of us do, you know where you're falling time and time again in temptation, the issues that you're struggling with, start there. Let that be where you make an annual objective to tackle that, to heal that, to get it out of your life. It's going to take self-examination. 2 Corinthians 13:5 tells us that this is a process that all of us have to do. And it's through self-examination that you're going to save your soul. So, but we need self-examination to be able to accurately set our annual objectives. 2 Corinthians 13:5 says, "Examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except you be reprobates." So, we're told to examine our hearts, to look at our lives, to reflect on that. And we need to look at how good of a steward we are with what God has already given us. That's one area where we can look. You know, if God has given you money, how do you use that money? Do you use it in the right way? Do you bringing glory to God through it, or are you hoarding it in ways that are unhealthy spiritually? Are you laying up treasure on earth? What about your time, how you spend your time? Are you a good steward of that? You know, God gives you, you may have a job where you have a lot of extra time on your hands, or you may be retired, or you may have big chunks of time that you can spend. How are you spending it? You know, are you doing it in a way that's edifying yourself? You know, maybe you do have time to study, you do have time to pray, but instead you're doing something different. And we need to examine ourselves and see if that's the case. What about your relationships? Are you a good steward in your relationships? What kind of parent have you been? Are you spending time with your kids? What kind of spouse are you? What kind of friend are you? Are you doing your best with what God has already given you? So look at what God has given you. If He's blessed you with family, then you need to work on, you know, looking at areas of being a better father, looking at areas of being a better spouse or wife or whatever the case is. So, and kids, you can do this too. You know, you can look at better ways to obey your parents and the Lord. Next thing we need to do is we just need to look honestly and courageously to see where we have room for growth. But consider your talents. That would be another area where I look. What has God gifted you with, talent-wise? What kind of skills and abilities do you have? In Matthew chapter 25, we see that God expects you and I to make use of whatever He gives us with. And in Matthew chapter 25, I'd like to look at verses 15 through 30. It's a parable of talents. It says, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to every man according as his several ability. And straightway he took his journey. Then he that had received 5 talents went and traded them the same and made another 5. And likewise he that had received 2, he also gained another 2. But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. And after a long time the Lord of the servants cometh and reckoneth with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought another 5, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 more. His Lord said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. He also that received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. But then he that had received 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not straw. And I was afraid, and I went and hid my talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast what is thine. The Lord answered him and said, Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gather where I have not straw. Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received my own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him, and give it to him that hath 10 talents. For every one that hath shall be given, and from him that, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away, even that which he has. I cast you, the unprofitable servant, into outer darkness. There shall be weeping, gnashing of teeth." Think about what that's saying. Now, we need to look at our talents. What has God blessed you with? You have the ability to teach. If you have that gift, use it. You know, maybe you're afraid to. It's a scary thing to get up and teach. But it's more scary to stand before God and say, God, I was afraid to do that. You'd be like that 1 talent servant. So start out as a helper. You know, you can even be a substitute. Just fill in when somebody can't make it, like I'm doing today. Maybe it's leading a prayer. Maybe it's the singing. You know, God has given you those kind of talents. Use them in His glory. Use them in His service. And don't be too afraid, but be too afraid not to. That's the real thing we need to fear. We shouldn't fear what other people are going to think about us, you know, when we stand up here or do things. in God's service, we shouldn't be afraid of that. We should be afraid of not doing it and realizing that God gave us the ability to do it, and we shirked that. We didn't carry out our responsibility. Don't hide your talent. God's going to bless you for being available. You know, when God sees you pushing against your fear, when He sees you getting up and doing what you're afraid to do, I call that hugging the monster. When you do that, it's showing God that you're willing to make sacrifices, that you're willing to do uncomfortable things, you're willing to come out of your comfort zone, you're willing to step forward for Him. And God can multiply and magnify our efforts. I always think of the little boy that had the few fishes and the few loaves. You know, what if when the disciples asked who has lunch here, and the little boy looked at his and said, what's this going to do among this crowd? You know, what good is this pocket going to do? I'm not going to give this to them. That would be ridiculous. I think I'm dumb. You know, I don't have this much food. What if the little boy would have been afraid to speak up? But instead, he gave his lunch, didn't he? And God multiplied it, and He magnified it. And it's the same with you and I. The little humble efforts that we give, He's going to make it work. It's not what you say, it's what you're saying. It's the seed, the word, that brings about growth. So, you know, if you can cook for the shut-ins, or cook for grieving people, or host a fellowship at your home, you know, if that's your talent, use it in the right way. God's going to bless that. Use your job skills to help your neighbors or the elderly, or people who are in need. You know, if you have a special skill that you're able to do, share that with other people who need that service. That's one good way to use your talents. So when you're setting your annual objectives, consider your talents. You know, maybe you need to be stepping up and doing something that you've been afraid to do in the past. Be too afraid not to. Next, we need to be realistic. Make these annual objectives obtainable. Use small, measurable increments. You know, instead of saying, I'm going to pray all day, I'm going to pray without ceasing, why don't you say, I'm going to pray 15 minutes more than I'm doing now. Or I'm going to pray daily. I'm going to do my best to pray daily. You know, just take a little bite. Take a little step. Study some daily. Don't set yourself up for failure by saying, I'm going to study 2 hours a day. You know what's going to happen with that. I mean, I'm glad there's some people here that may study 2 hours a day, and maybe even more than that. And that's great. You're going to experience phenomenal growth if you do that. But just improve on what you're currently doing. You know, make it an attainable step. Make it something that you can see yourself achieving. So instead of saying, well, I'm going to baptize one person a month, that's 12 people in a year, just say, I'm going to use every opportunity that God gives me to teach and to evangelize. I'm going to have courage to speak up when I need to. I'm going to say the right word in those occasions when I need to speak up. If you just do that, that's a small step forward. And we need to aim for a goal that's just more than what we're currently doing. Make it measurable. You can set a date on it, or you can measure it in some other way so that you can track if you're improving. How do we keep our annual objectives? You know, when we set goals spiritually, how can we keep them? First of all, I think it's very important that we write them down. And then when you think it up, when you're brainstorming, write it down. If it's a goal worthy to aim for, write that goal down. Describe what you plan to achieve and the steps to get there. Define it in measurable quantity or frequency or date. The next step is to review your goals daily. You know, that piece of paper that you write your goals on, keep it available. Put it in your car. When you get stopped in traffic, look at it. Don't be reading it while you're driving down the road. No, don't do that. But keep it available. If you have a moment, maybe you're eating lunch in your car, you can lay it on the seat, take a look at it while you're eating. Post it wherever you're going to be, at home or work or in your car. Have periodic checkups to track how you're doing. You know, if you write down in a journal some of the things that you're doing for spiritual growth, and you look back over the year and say, wow, I've really come a long way. You know, journaling captures that so that it doesn't just evaporate. You forget about it. Write it on a calendar. If you find that your goal that you've set or your annual objective is too difficult, or if you're slacking it, make adjustments. You know, change it a little bit. Don't just fail at it. Just change it. Make it a little easier for you to attain. And then ask for God's help in prayer. James 5:16, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. When we go to God asking for help to attain spiritual goals, you know that pleases God. You know that God's going to listen. You know God's going to give you the help that you need. Some examples of annual objectives that we could set would be daily devotions. You know, that's something you could either do it for yourself, you could do it with you and your spouse, you could do it with you and your kids. But that's a great